the two thing I can always remember. One, the, when I qualify for Olympics in 1988 Seoul and represent there, I couldn't do better due to some reason. And second, you know, second or first, you can say both is first for me, Asian Games medal. After 1951, I was the only swimmer who got 1986. And still today, this is the only medal we have in swimming for our country. And I feel that somebody should win in future, but they have to do more and more hard work.
I got 5 gold medals in the national, with all national records. And I select for Commonwealth Games and Asian Games.
I'm looking after my team as a manager, coach. I'm giving advice to them also, coaching, my experience and all. And I'll try to manage everything for my young coming up swimmers and giving exposure to them and my experience in competition.
What coach said that whenever I swim with that my Indian swimmers, they always swim 3 stroke, I'll go 1 stroke. 2 stroke. So advantage of 1 stroke I always get. They go 3, I'll go 2. And the second thing, like, I'm not saying, I don't know what about my body. My whole part is, as they said, equal with swimming. Some people have short legs, some people have short hand. But I have everything perfectly all right. If you count that other swimmers have big hand, mine have small hand. But still, I can manage, push more than them. Only because of flexibility in body and swimming fitness body of my God. Baad mein given in little correction by the coaches. But whenever I swim any stroke, I never ask anybody, like, I have to do this. I'll change myself. And when I change, it is absolutely correct.
See, as per international swimming standard, coaches and, you know, others abroad people said, a swimmer should start in the age of 3 or 4. And when he come on at 11, 12, he should be in the right position to represent country in other 2-3 years for Asian Games and National and Olympics and Commonwealth. But in our country, I start very late, frankly speaking. And the age of 13, I start. Age of 17 or 18, first competition I participate. I picked up very fast. But as per international feeling, they start and 14 or 15, they will be a national member, team members or something like that. So always count, you start early, pick early, teach them early.
डीडी स्पोर्ट्स कॉन्क्लेव 2017 में आपका एक बार फिर से स्वागत है। आज हम स्पोर्ट्स और खेलो इंडिया का जश्न मना रहे हैं डीडी स्पोर्ट्स के माध्यम से। वेल, खेलो इंडिया स्कीम की अगर हम बात करें तो उसके 2 ड्राफ्टिंग मेंबर्स खुद बहुत लेजेंडरी और दिग्गज खिलाड़ी हैं, जैसे कि पुलेला गोपी चंद और अंजू बॉबी जॉर्ज। पुलेला गोपी चंद सिर्फ मेंटर और कोच अपने 3 एस चैंपियन बैडमिंटन खिलाड़ियों के लिए नहीं है, बल्कि देश के लिए भी हैं। आइए आपको ले चलते हैं हैदराबाद।
दिस इज डीडी स्पोर्ट्स हेडक्वार्टर इन दिल्ली। You are watching DD Sports Conclave
2017. Hyderabad, once known as the City of Pearls, has now become a city that produces top badminton players in the country. For this development, due credits must be given to Pulela Gopichand Nimagada Foundation Badminton Academy, situated at IT suburb of Gachibowli. Founded by the 2001 All England Open Badminton champion Pulela Gopichand, this facility has trained the Indian Olympic medalists Saina Nehwal, PV Sindhu and many other Olympians in the likes of Parupalli Kashyap, Srikanth Kidambi and many others. By the time he won the All England Open Badminton Championships in 2001, Pulela Gopichand had decided to bring a world-class training facility for the next generation of badminton players. After undergoing several hurdles and financial exigencies, facility was eventually completed in 2008. The thus established academy played a key role in getting the Olympic bronze medal for Saina Nehwal in London Olympics 2012 and the silver medal for PV Sindhu in Rio Olympics 2016. As a part of the sports conclave, the DD Sports team visited the academy to bring out the role of the centers of excellences in the development of sports through the voices of Gopichand and other Olympians.
तमीज और तहजीब का ये शहर हैदराबाद समय के साथ बदल रहा है। निजामों का ये खूबसूरत शहर इसने अपनी एक नई पहचान बना ली है। वो पहचान है स्पोर्ट्स कैपिटल ऑफ इंडिया की। यहाँ से कई नामी ग्रामी खिलाड़ियों ने जन्म लिया। खेलों की बात करें मोहम्मद अजरुद्दीन, पुलेला गोपीचंद, ज्वाला गुट्टा, उसके अलावा गगन नारंग जैसे बड़े खिलाड़ी यहाँ से उभर कर आए। साइना नेहवाल, सानिया मिर्जा और हाल ही में 2016 रियो ओलंपिक्स में सिल्वर मेडल अपने नाम करने वाली पीवी सिंधु भी इसी शहर से हैं। इस शहर ने बैडमिंटन को काफी कुछ दिया है। अगर हम भारत की बात करते हैं तो ये देश ऐसा है जहां पे क्रिकेट एक रिलीजन है, जहां पर क्रिकेट को पूजा जाता है, लेकिन बैडमिंटन ने इतना कुछ अचीव किया है कि अब लोगों की सोच बदल चुकी है और इस सोच के पीछे इस शहर का पूरी तरह से हाथ है। इस समय हम हैं पुलेला गोपीचंद एकेडमी में, जिसका बहुत बड़ा हाथ है बैडमिंटन को सेकंड पॉपुलर स्पोर्ट्स बनाने का। इस देश में बैडमिंटन आज हाउसहोल्ड नाम बन चुका है। तो चलिए हम बातचीत करते हैं इन खिलाड़ियों से और साथ ही साथ पुलेला गोपीचंद से और जानते हैं कि किस तरह से बैडमिंटन उभर कर आ रहा है भारत में और भारत को स्पोर्टिंग नेशन बनाने के लिए क्या कुछ और करना होगा।
Welcome, Gopi. First thing, you have been a very great player. I mean, we have still not had anyone else after you winning the All England Championships. And you have transited very beautifully into an extraordinary coach. So what are the difficulties or how difficult was it for you to transition from a player to a coach?
Well, it's happened so smoothly in a way, in a lot of ways, because even when I was a player and I had my injuries, I would always think how could I help players, and there were a lot of these players, and then I would come to the stadium someday. It was kind of a routine to get to the stadium always, and whether I'm injured or not. And the day I was injured and wasn't able to play, I would stand there and say, okay, I can't play, but at least let me help the players. And that's how my initial days of coaching went. It was always like I would go there, if I was playing half a session, I would spend rest of the half of the session with the other players. And then I kind of transitioned smoothly, but I had to learn a lot. I had to have different experiences, but also had to study and interact with a lot of people actually to understand what my coaching philosophy is and how I could be better as a coach.
Well, I mean, it's not always that a player can be a good coach also, but you have shown not once but many times, and I think you have far being the best coach, best world-class coach we've ever had in Indian badminton. So how do you feel that a center of excellence, what role does a center of excellence plays in the Indian sports?
Well, I think there are stages in which players grow. There is socio-economic conditions which they go, culture which comes up. But I think by and large, beyond a point, to take them to the next level, I think you need centers of excellence, because there is a certain stage when kids play sport, it's important that they play sport. But after a certain point, there is where you need much more intense work. And for the intense work, you need a controlled environment. Because discipline, the culture of the place, I think determine a lot of things. And that's where I think centers of excellence are very important for the ecosystem.
So you feel at the moment we have only Pulela Gopichand Badminton Academy as the center of excellence, and it has been an excellent academy, probably a role model for most of the other academies. So do you see in future that we will have centers in different places around across India?
Well, I think it's most important that we actually build more centers, we build more things so that there is competition which drives each other to perform better. And also it's important that we have it across the country, because culturally we are so diverse. We are a country, but we are a continent in a way, because there's so distances are huge, cultures are different. We are one, but also we are different in a lot of ways. So I think from that perspective, when you look, it's important to have more centers of excellence, but it's also very important that buildings don't make centers of excellence. It's not the building or the infrastructure, because many of the times the thinking is that I need to build something to make it world class. It is people who make it world class. So I think it's very important for us to create an environment where we have people who are world class, coaches who are world class, and there is enough ecosystem around them, and that is a center of excellence. So I would really love to see people who have passion, who have dedication, and who have knowledge to come into the sport and take this really as a nation building exercise, as a pride for the nation exercise. And it's a long haul. So I think they need to spend, and we need to create a right environment for those people to succeed.
Well, I mean, when you said we need the expert coaches, it's as we all know, it's only one Pulela Gopichand we have with us, and who can't be there at the same time in all the places. So we have a dearth of expert coaches in our country. We need a lot of world-class coaches. So how is this issue we are going to overcome?
Well, I think, as I said, I think players, preferably players, because they have an understanding of the sport and they have probably played the sport for a longer period of time. Those are the ones who could become good coaches. But they need to have good education as well. And also they need to kind of dedicate themselves to the sport. And it's important for the system to work as an enabler for these people. Because many of the times you will have players who are good, but kind of the system breaks them down. I think we need to have a system which enables them to do well. And the right environment and the right competition is also important. It's important that we develop the right environment and the right competition, because that is what will strive people to keep pushing forward.
Okay. So when you talk about the system, how difficult it was when you started, when you took over as a chief coach in 2006. And we had, since I have played earlier as well, so I knew it has been a complete contrast transition before 2006 and after that. So how it was hard for you to convince the people around you, whether it could be the association or the concerned members, how difficult was it for you?
I think by and large, we were okay with mediocrity. We were okay with going one step ahead, but kind of never believed the fact that we could be good and consistent in producing results. And when we actually started, I started coaching in 2004. And then when I started for the initial couple of years, I would say things, and except my core group of players, not many believed that it was possible. And then slowly, it took time. I have to be honest that not many people believed the vision. They said, it's okay, it's just trying something, he could achieve what he did. But I don't think Indians in general could. So the idea was, I am not good enough, we are not good enough, but maybe a pre-quarter final as a top 30 in the world once in a while is good enough. But the real top names are not there, especially women's badminton was a big challenge, because we've always had good players at a certain level, but really we couldn't consistently produce players who've been top 10, top 5, like that. In the men's, at least we had me, Prakash sir, in the earlier times, Nandu Nateker, Dinesh Khanna, at least people who had played at the highest level in the world. But the women, it wasn't, because many of the times when I would have a conversation with coaches and players, the very thought is Indian women are not strong enough. And that was something which I didn't believe. And it was great because Saina was there to start things rolling. And once it happened, and then the men started believing, and then the other girls started believing, and then it just had a rolling effect. And today is what you have, about 7 people in the top 30-40 of the world, and then you have the girls doing well, 2 in the top 10. I think we've done pretty well.
You have an eye for a talent, and not only an eye for a talent, but also you nurture that talent which you pick or choose. So this is something which is your forte, you know, which is what separates you from the rest of the coaches and all. So how do you do this? How, probably I'm asking you the secret question. Well, but then, I think I'm sure everybody would like to know, you know, what goes in your mind when you're trying to pick some of the players and, you know, thinking that tomorrow they are potential enough and I'm going to put them on the Olympic podium.
Well, I think there's nothing like it's a super secret or something. I think the fact is that I think one of the things which is very interesting, and strangely so, is when people talk about talent. When I started coaching in 2004, a lot of these kids were very young. In a sense, Sindhu was one of the youngest, about 8.5, 9 years old. Kashyap was about 16 when we started. But the fact is that out of that group of maybe 25 odd people, we had somebody like a Sai Praneet, somebody like a Kashyap, Guru Saidat, Sikki Reddy, Sumit Reddy, so about 7-8 of them in that group really who've played top 50 in the world. So basically, I don't think there's a dearth of talent anywhere, and I would rather say that if you pick 20 kids, 25 kids, there's definitely 8-10 of them who are good. If there is something, it is a lack of a system and a lack of a proper structure around it, and I think that's what's important. So especially for badminton, I think anywhere in the country, if you pick 20 kids, I'm sure there'll be talent. It's like, it's a done thing. How you pick talent? I think you need to look at the people, their background, and also the innate energy which they want to put in. Some of them have a lot of internal drive. Some of them would have a lot of conviction on the coach. And I think, or somebody might just respond very well when the opportunity comes. I think any of these, if you pick, I think there is definitely a lot you can achieve.
Talking about the system, our Prime Minister has taken a keen interest in sports, especially after the Olympics. What do you think now? He has started following the Olympics, a task force committee, and you are heading the task force committee. Where do you find the constraints and what would be your challenges?
Well, I think the very good people in the committee who have knowledge of sport, understanding, but more importantly, I think the way the country has responded in a way to sport, and thanks largely to the initiative of the Prime Minister, because he has consistently spoken about it in a Mann Ki Baat, and nowhere, no time before has anybody, any office, the highest office in our country, has spoken about sport so much. So generally, there's a general enthusiasm about sport, and there's a genuine concern about sport wanting to move forward. And it's great to see the Prime Minister make those tweets, make those mentions, and that's, I think, wonderful. It is not only about winning, but also midway through the games, when people weren't really winning, he came up and said, "It doesn't matter, I'm still proud of my sports person." So that's a huge, huge thing. I think for us in Rio, I think it was hugely motivating. And when you come back and you see the kind of response, and you kind of see the initiatives taken, you start to feel confident that there is something good going to happen. And yes, the Prime Minister's task force is something which is fantastic. but also the generic direction in which the focus towards sport is in the country has been driven to. I think it's the best time we have had for sport.
So how do you feel, you know, now we have, you have set a P. Gopichandra model, rather a P. Gopichandra system. So how well can we put it across in the other disciplines where we participate in the Olympic sports? So how do you feel that this could help, or, you know, a replicate of the same model?
I think it's, the key is to understand that building infrastructure is the easiest thing to do. It's important that infrastructure is needed, but at the end of the day, we need to ensure that there are good coaches who will be driving the system. And we should have the ecosystem around sport actually work as an enabler to ensure that the coach and the athlete are taken care of, the athlete being the primary focus. And we should ensure that whatever happens, the athlete is always on the path of excellence. I think that's what's important. And for that to happen, for us, we need to create more coaches. And for us to create more coaches, we need to get the best brains back into the sport. And for that to happen, a lot of work needs to be done, because guru, coach today, is feels left out in the system. We don't have the pride of coaching. So top players don't come back to coaching. The top players are not respected back in the system doesn't respect the coach as much as it's needed, because in any top system which works, it needs to be coach led and athlete centric. And we need to ensure that our system enables this to happen.
Take us through your, you know, memories of Rio.
Well, I think the Olympic preparation is something which is very important, because the lead up to the Olympics, the training which you go through actually sets the tone for what you do at the Games. And luckily for me, I've had experience of, as a coach, as a player I was there in Sydney, but as a coach I was there in Beijing and the London Olympics. So actually those things help. So I kind of, about 3 months before the Olympics, there was this Australian Open. So I traveled to Australia. We came back, I was sitting in that room and I said, Sindhu, this is our plan, we need to do this. And I was very fortunate that I had a friend of mine from Canada, who's a physiologist of the highest order. He actually helped me plan the training part to perfection. So I took his help. We had a clear plan of what was going on. And then we kind of broke it down into phases. And I think that day we decided that I was going to be perfect and she was perfect. And then we got our diet chart, our training chart, our recovery chart, and all of it to perfection. And I think Sindhu's been an amazing athlete. I think for her, we started sessions every day. We didn't want anybody around. So it was kind of very early. We would start off at 4:15. We would train till about 6:30 and then have an hour and a half break. Come back at 8, we would train till about 10, and come back at 11:30, do a lot of technical work, and then the physical workouts in the evening. And for the next every day till the end of the Olympics, till the final match was played, she didn't have a phone with her, she wasn't allowed to eat her anything outside of what was needed to perform well. Her sleep was monitored, and I think it was fantastic. I think it was like a dream journey all through. I was kind of a little paranoid that I would get injured or something, so I was extra careful, and I was in the best shape what I've been in the last few years. So kind of it worked very well, because at the end of the day, a lot of the higher level performances is about peaking at the right moment. And I think very glad that we were able to do that.
So it sounds more like that you had a different roles to play, not only as a coach, but look more like a parent, you know, taking care of everything, what she's going to eat, what she's not going to do, when she's going to sleep, even like taking a phone off. Who do you think is the next big name in the top league?
Well, I think I have about 40 odd kids and another 80 of them. And if I were to pick one name, it would be very unfair. So I would not risk taking that name.
Maybe
but
a few.
I would say that even if I take a few, I'll miss a few. So I would say that there's a whole bunch of juniors who are doing well, and there is a huge amount of potential. And when we look at the Asian Grand Prix, which happened last month in Indonesia, out of the 8 quarterfinals, we had 5 quarterfinals from the academy, and that's something very good because both the winner and the runner, out of the 4 semifinals, we had 3 from the academy. And I think it just proves that there is good talent coming up. If we need something, it's up for us to ensure that the system is done well. The world has improved. The world keeps revising their systems. And if we don't act in a manner which is dynamic, which is scientific, which is well oiled in terms of getting all the stakeholders together, I think whatever gains we've had, we will also lose it. So I think it's very important that we on one side enjoy the successes what we have, but I think to expect that things will be better just because they've been better in the last few years is not going to happen, because I think when you look at countries, they have kind of developed their systems, and for us it's important that we as a nation work together and we as a unit are working together, because our biggest strength is, in a human sense, is our population. And I think we need to leverage it. We need to ensure that diverse populations, diverse people are brought together, and that's what's important.
So, Gopi, where do you see 10 years down the line the Indian sports and yourself?
Well, I think the momentum which we've seen in the last year, year and a half, if you were to see, I think there's a huge way in which Indian sport will grow. But also the fact is, it's the need of the hour, and a lot of people who are conscious, who are in decision making, see people's children's health going down and lack of physical activity becoming a huge impediment for physical performance, mental performance. And I think that is what is going to drive it. I think as a nation, one is to look at sports and medals, but I think the larger issue is to ensure that we as a country are physically better, because I think we will be spending huge amounts of money to just get our health back. And to counter it, I think physical activity is needed. We've moved to a stage where there is abundance in a lot of things. We've kind of, we started it, food being lesser. Today, some areas we have food surplus, some areas we have power surplus, and we are moving towards a lot of surpluses. And when you have those as a developed nation, I think the more, or a developed society or a developed ecosystem where a certain people have a lot of resources, I think sport becomes paramount, physical activity becomes paramount. And for us, for the health of the nation, and for us, it is very important that we look at sport very differently than what we've done. Sport, culture, and art actually are very important. Gurus and coaches and teachers are very important, and we as an ecosystem need to start believing and investing in these, because if we have to progress as a nation, I think these are key components.
Well, I mean, you know, the mindset of the Indians always has been that, you know, we take up sport, when am I going to get an Olympic medal? The next question is that, you know, when a kid at the age of 8 or 9. And I think, as you rightly said, we should take it as initially like a health initiative, and slowly and take it forward to look at getting medals in future. So Gopi, most of our, rather 50% of our Indian population, we have youth. So what would be your message for them?
I think there are a lot of areas in which sport can contribute. And today maybe the only parameter which we are able to see is the medals, but the day our assessing mechanism becomes better, we'll realize that sport helps health, sport helps the nation building, sports help communities, sports helps your confidence, and a lot of these things we will be able to assess it in a scientific manner, and probably that is when parents and youth will start looking at sport differently. But for me, I believe that sport, when we look back, whether it's Vivekananda saying that I would rather play football first than do meditation, I think those kind of statements, or Aurobindo and the mother talk about physical culture as an important aspect, or our previous generations, whether it's the times when Mahabharata and the Ramayana, where archery, wrestling, these were actually sports, and akhadas were the training grounds, and gurus were teaching this as a main subject. I think we need to understand that sport has, Indian culture has sport ingrained in it, and a lot we can learn from our sport, and medals is only one aspect of it.